everybody. This is Christopher with AG Productions, and welcome to another video. It's been a while since we've done a book review here on film, and I said in the 2012 recap video that it was something we'd start doing again, because last time we did it with the Gotrek and Felix Omnibus, it was fairly well received, and it's something that we should be able to do fairly easily, because I tend to read a lot of books. So we're going to start the 2013 book review season off with a book that I just finished reading, Xenos, which is the first book of the Eisenhorn trilogy by Dan Abnett. Now, the odds are pretty good that you're not going to be able to find, well, let's rephrase that, you're probably not going to walk into the local bookstore or the local hobby shop and find the book Xenos by itself, as you see in the picture before you. What you'll probably find is the Eisenhorn Omnibus, which is just as good. I mean, it actually comes with two extra stories, two little short stories mixed in between the three books of the trilogy. But for right now, we're simply going to take a look at the first book in the series. Now, this is not my first foray into a Dan Abnett book. I've read many, many, many of his books before, and this one is a little different. Overall impression of the book, I gotta be honest with you, it kind of gave me one of those meh kind of things. It wasn't great, but it wasn't horrible. But we'll get there. Let's kind of start off and just sort of go through a few key points. And there may be some spoilers in this. I tried to kind of avoid spoilers the last time we did this review with the Gotrek and Felix Omnibus. But in order to do a full, complete review, in some ways you need to give examples from the book, and that could be counted as spoilers. So if you're not interested in hearing some of the things that may have occurred in the book, then feel free to stop watching the video now. If you don't mind, keep watching and maybe, you know, you can pick the book up and decide for yourself. Okay. The writing style of Xenos is very interesting. It's done in a first-person style, which is fine. I don't mind that at all. You get a little bit of insight inside the character's brain and things like that, so it adds a little bit of extra depth to your main character. It does create a significant problem, which we'll talk about in a few minutes. First of all, I want to talk about the prologue of this book, because the prologue of this book, to be perfectly honest with you, is very, very, very well done. The idea of the prologue sort of starts off with you as the reader taking on the persona of someone, and that someone we do not find out who it is. But what you see before you on the page is what this person is seeing, which is a computer readout or a computer printout, and basically the idea is that this computer is loading up a sort of like a video file that you're going to start watching, and this file starts playing, and as you're reading the book you learn what specific images are flashing up before you and things like that, and it's essentially the a video recording, I'm assuming from like a helmet or shoulder cam, of someone who is running through like this ancient temple with an inquisitor in front of them, and they're going into battle trying to find this agent of chaos. And the way it's done, the way the prologue is done, is very, very well executed. If the entire book had been written like that, I think it would have been absolutely incredible to read. Excuse me. I seem to be developing a little bit of a cold here, so if I sound a little funny, I apologize. It's a unique style of writing in that you don't, it's not prose. It's not even like stream of consciousness from a first-person perspective. You're getting a data readout, essentially, from a computer. And it's very, very cool. It's very well done. If you don't read anything else from the book, I would just encourage you to read the prologue, because the prologue is one of those things, it sort of sucks you in, because it makes you think that this is going to be a really, really adventurous ride. And the prologue introduces a very, what could become, anyway, a very formidable foe, in the form of this chaos persona, I believe Cherubabel, I think is what the character was called. Let me check on that just to be safe. Don't want to feed you incorrect information. Cherubel, we'll call it that. Cherubel, that's good enough. And you end up with this sort of idea after the prologue is over, like, wow, this is a really, really cool enemy. But, and this is something that we'll talk about a little bit later on, this is sort of like, as I read through the book, I to be honest with you, I kind of forgot about the guy. Because he's not mentioned again. Not in name form, at least. For a very, very long time. And so what you end up with is a really cool looking or a cool build-up for a bad guy. But in the end, nothing really happens. And it reminds me so much of the trailers for The Phantom Menace back in the late 90s. You had this red and black tattooed face guy with all these horns coming out of his head. A bow staff lightsaber. And you think to yourself, wow, this guy is going to be absolutely awesome. And in the end, he's a complete pathetic loser and he falls down a pit. That's kind of the way this bad guy is. You get this really cool buildup, and then it just kind of fizzles. It's kind of like a Roman candle. And by the way, that's not the first comparison to Star Wars you're going to get in this review. But, like I said, the prologue itself is very, very cool. It's a fantastic read. Unfortunately, it just doesn't really tie in with the rest of the book. Now, I've heard, I haven't read the other two books yet, but I've heard that it sort of fleshes itself out a little bit more in the later books. But as far as this book as a standalone, it really doesn't fit with the rest of the novel. So, great prologue, though. As far as the characters go, let's talk about characters, because this is kind of where the book, in some ways, it's really well done, and in other ways, it's really badly done. you have two types of characters in the book. Well, you really have technically three. You have your protagonist, which are your good guys. You have your antagonist, your bad guys. And then you have your sort of outside ancillary characters who, you know, you can kind of take them or leave them. They fall into either good or bad category, but they're not really in the novel for any great length of time, and so it doesn't really matter. It could just be called, hey, we met this guy. They don't technically even need a name. They're just kind of thrown in there just for a scene or two to accomplish something. But the protagonists, the good guys, for the most part, are very, very well done. And a lot of this, I'll get to that in just a moment. But you find out a lot about the characters. You get a lot of sort of background story on some of them. You kind of, you get a very good mental image of what they look like. You get an idea of their motivations, of what sort of, I'll tell you, one of the ways you can tell whether or not you've got a really good writer who can do a really good character development is when you have a writer and you've been reading through this book, and when a character is presented with a conflict or a challenge of some kind, you know, based upon how that character normally would act and how that character thinks, you can pretty much guarantee what their actions will be in that situation. That's the way it is with the good guys in this book. For the most part, they're all very, very well thought out, and you end up with a really good combination of characters who kind of play off of each other. You've got Eisenhorn, who's the Inquisitor, who's just a fairly well-rounded character. You get, you get a lot more of his interpersonal thoughts than anything, because the book is written in first-person perspective. And so you do learn a lot about him and kind of what his motivations and things like that are. Then you end up with Midas Betancourt, who is sort of Eisenhorn's, like, I guess, right-hand man in a way. He's a pilot of one of his ships, and he's just sort of this almost like a mercenary type figure in a way. Very, very fun character. You end up with a character named Beckwin, who is a very unique character. I've never, I don't know a whole lot about the fluff of the 40K universe, but namely because I don't read codices, but I do read a lot of the novels and things like that, and I've never heard of this ability before, but apparently this girl, Beckwin, has the ability to cancel any psychic field or psychic vibrations around her. And so this attribute that she has is not simply mentioned in the book. Like, many times you'll find books, they'll mention character attributes that a character has, and it doesn't really affect the story that much. Whereas in this story, Eisenhorn specifically takes this girl, Beckwin, and basically tells her, hey, your job for the rest of your life is to stand next to me. Because as long as you're standing next to me, anyone that tries to assault me with psychic powers is going to be unsuccessful. Because their psychic powers get nullified by your simple presence next to me. And that's a very, very interesting idea. It's a very cool ability, and it was very well used throughout the book. There are instances where Eisenhorn is in Beckwin's sort of sphere of protection, and at a critical moment, something happens, and he's watching, you know, the enemy a ways away, and all of a sudden he feels like these psychic attacks coming at him, and he looks, and Beckwin's gone. And so you notice immediately this difference, and it's a very, very well-played character. It was one of my favorite characters of the entire book. You have a gentleman named Maxilla, who's like the captain of this very large spaceship. You have an Adeptus Arbite named Fashig, who you come to know very well, who you kind of get a little bit of backstory on, but throughout the book, he's a little bit more developed as the story progresses. Like I said, all the good guys, the protagonists, are very, very well done. The problem that I had with the characters is in the bad guys. And the problem stems from the fact that the book is written in first-person perspective. Because the book is written in first-person perspective, you have absolutely no insight whatsoever as to who your bad guys are. To contrast this, if you take a look at many other fantasy books, you will find, or even sci-fi books, you will find the general rule of thumb is you have two groups of characters with two storylines flowing simultaneously, and at some point throughout the book, those two storylines will intersect and become one storyline. Generally speaking, you have one storyline at the beginning of the book for the protagonist and one storyline for the antagonist, and they're all told in the perspective of sort of God mode, if you will, in that when you're viewing the protagonist's storyline, you get all of the motivation, you get all of the character development as if you were looking down on them and knew everything about them. And then the exact same thing happens with the antagonists, all right? But because you're in first-person perspective in this book, Xenos, you have absolutely no idea who these bad guys are, where they come from, what their motivations are. And, you know, to be perfectly honest with you, most of these guys, they're forgettable characters because you've got nothing, that they've got no support. You barely remember what they look like half the time. Their names are so rarely mentioned, with the exception of one guy named Gorgon Locke, who happens to run throughout the entire book. But everybody else who's a quote-unquote bad guy is just, they're basically forgettable because you know nothing about them. And so you cannot get drawn into the character to be interested in the character. And that is a very, very big drawback for me, at least, as far as this book. So, sorry, I had to take a drink of water. But there's just no detail. You know, I began wondering, you know, as I read this book, you know, who are these people? And what are they doing in my book? Are they main bad guys? Are they bad guys that are showing up just for this scene so they can be killed? What's you know, to steal a Seinfeld quote, what's the deal? You know, and by the way, 3-4 chapters into this thing, I'm wondering, what happened to the bad guy from the prologue? Where is he? What's he doing? You know, why is he not making an appearance? And so it's just, it's, I don't know, the bad guys just, they're not very well done. And, excuse me, you know, this has been discussed before in the comic book realm. Especially this past summer, I remember seeing several reviews of both the Avengers as well as the Dark Knight Rises. And many, many, many of the reviews pointed out that the reason they preferred the Dark Knight Rises to the Avengers was the antagonists, the foes. You get a much deeper perspective as to what makes them tick, and it makes it sort of makes the storyline progress much easier. And you kind of understand not necessarily just that they're bad, but you understand why the good guy is trying to stop them from what they're doing. And it really helps to pull you into the story, all right? And so, we just don't have that here with bad guys. As I said, the really cool bad guy in the prologue, he just disappears after the prologue. He actually appears in dreams that Eisenhorn has, but it doesn't refer to him by name. It only refers to him as, quote, the blank-eyed man. Now, unfortunately, if you're a fast reader like I am, there is one phrase in the prologue that calls this guy the blank-eyed man. And, I mean, it's like stuffed into the middle of a sentence, so if you happen to not remember that one little phrase, you might possibly think that the guy Eisenhorn is seeing in his dreams is somebody else. That's what I thought. I had no idea. And to be honest with you, by like chapter 4 or 5, I had completely forgotten about the guy in the prologue. I had forgotten that there even was a prologue. All right? And then, oh my goodness, at the end of the book, the guy reappears in front of Eisenhorn, and they have a battle, a quote-unquote battle, who are we kidding? The guy reappears for less than 2 pages. If you want to get really technical, if you take all the sentences where he talks and, like, basically where he appears, talks, and then disappears, it's less than a page and a half. So you've got this really cool build-up in the prologue for an awesome bad guy. He's never mentioned again throughout the entire book, with the exception of kind of being pseudo-referred to in dreams, and then he shows up again at the very end of the book for a page and a half. It's just not well done. You know, it's something that I just wish had been done better, and I think, like I said, a lot of that could have been solved by not doing the book in first-person perspective. If it was done in third-person, sort of demigod perspective, where you can see the motivations and the thoughts of every single character, it would have been much, much more balanced as far as the interest in the characters go. Now, that's the characters. You know, like I said, good guys were great, bad guys really left something to be desired. As far as the story itself, to be perfectly honest with you, there's just not enough of it. I felt like, well, there was too much fluff, And what I mean by fluff is that there are a lot of very descriptive sections in this book, and the descriptions are always of environment, it's always of battle scenes and things like that. And you get the idea after a while that Dan Abnett was given a page number. Let's say 200, 300 pages. Let's say 300 pages. And he was told, okay, fill up 300 pages, but don't go a word over 300. And so you get this idea that he wrote this book with these really nice descriptions of the environment that he's in, the battles that are happening, the character motivations and things like that for your good guys. And in the end, what happens? Well, the story just stops. I mean, it's almost like he gets to page 290 and realizes, oh crap, I gotta wrap this thing up. Let's do it as fast as possible. And then, you know, 10 pages later, boom, you're done. And so it's just, it almost feels like if that's the way it was written, where the guys in the Black Library wanted a certain page count for their book, which there are many publishers that do that because they figure if it's over a certain page count, they're going to have to charge more for it, and they figure people won't purchase it at that price. So they say, okay, you can only write this number of pages. And so you get this idea that almost in a way that all of these descriptive wordings and things like that can kind of just be thrown out, and if they were thrown out, he could have added more to the storyline. And the storyline, you know, it's okay, but there's just nothing to it. The basic plot of the storyline is Eisenhorn is following these agents of chaos around. They're going after, or they're attempting to find this book called the Nekruteuk, which we'll talk about in just a second. And he's trying to stop them. Okay, well, that's pretty simplistic in and of itself. And you get some various battles and things like that here and there, but there's just nothing to it. I mean, that's really the gist of the book. It's Eisenhorn sees bad guy, bad guy's going after something, Eisenhorn must stop them. And that's it. That's your book, in and of itself. I'd love to give you more than that, but that's the entire review right there. That's the summary of the book. You know, stop bad guy from getting book. Now let's talk about that book, by the way. The Nekruteuk is apparently this chaos book that was written centuries, millennia perhaps even, before the story of Eisenhorn takes place in this book Xenos. Number one question that I had was, what exactly is this book? What does it do? Alright? And here is a paraphrased version of what this sort of inquisitorial council or inquisitorial roundtable that they had inside this book, Xenos, says about the Nekruteuk. Alright, now I'll not quote because it's a pretty lengthy discussion, but basically, when asked, what does the book do? The council members respond with something along the lines of, well, we don't really know, but it's bad. And that's all you get. So, going back to the idea of a storyline, we have bad guys going after ancient artifact that is quote-unquote bad, although we have no idea what bad means, and Eisenhorn must stop them. Now, to contrast that, I would like to read to you a little excerpt from a film that many of you are familiar with called Ghostbusters to explain to you how storytelling should go, okay? The Ghostbusters are in an elevator, and they're going on their first ghost hunt, and here's what the conversation begins with. Dr. Egon says, there's something very important I forgot to tell you. Finkman says, what? Don't cross the streams. All right? Why? Now, Egon's response is, it would be bad. Okay, now if we just stopped right there and that was the end of the conversation, we would never know what crossing the streams could do, all right? You know, bad could mean, you know, it might set fire to something. Bad could mean it would cut the power out of the machine so they wouldn't work anymore, and then they'd be in real danger because, you know, they'd have all these ghosts coming at them. But it doesn't stop there. That's not where the conversation ends. The conversation keeps going, and Venkman says, I'm fuzzy on the whole good-bad thing. What do you mean, bad? All right, that's what I wanted to know about the Necrotaic. What is bad? And you never get the explanation. But here's the explanation from Ghostbusters, just in case you forgot. Try to imagine all life as you know it stopping instantaneously and every molecule in your body exploding at the speed of light. And Ray says, total protonic reversal. Right, that's bad. Okay, all right. Important safety tip. Thanks, Egon. Okay, now, here's the thing. Aside from being a very funny scene, it sets the storyline up. Because at the very end of the movie, the only thing that they can do to defeat the bad guy is the one thing that could possibly cause a cataclysmic destruction of the entire universe. Now, if they had just stopped at don't cross the streams because it would be bad, and then you get to that end scene, and they said, okay, what we have to do here is cross the streams. Well, okay, I mean, you know, bad could mean something much, much less harsh than the cataclysmic doom of the entire universe. But because we have that description, we know what crossing the streams could potentially do. But with this Necrotaic here, we have no idea the power of this book that the antagonists of Xenos are trying to find. And so it's just, you know, there's nothing to it. You just, I don't know how to put it other than, well, let me think. It just doesn't seem like it's that big of a deal, I guess I should say. There's no buildup as to what this book can do, so you kind of like, well, who the hell cares if they get the book or not? What does it matter? You know, it just wasn't played out very well, all right? So, there are a lot of really, really bad issues with the storyline in this thing. Another thing that really, really just absolutely irritated the crap out of me was throughout the book, at various times, Eisenhorn will speak to his right-hand man, Midas, which, by the way, let's cover this one while we're at it. For the first, like, 8 chapters of the book, he refers to Midas by his last name, Betancourt. And then throughout the entire rest of the book, he refers to him as Midas. So, like, in that interim transition where he switches from calling him Betancourt to calling him Midas, I had a heck of a time trying to figure out who he was talking about, because I had forgotten what the guy's first name was. And so I had to go all the way back until I could find the guy's first name, figure out who he was talking about, and go, oh, I don't know why he's calling him Midas. Maybe he'll stop and go back to Betancourt here in a little bit. But nope, he called him Midas throughout the rest of the book. So, very, very odd styling. Anyway, throughout the book, at various times, Eisenhorn will talk to both Midas as well as another guy on his crew named Imus. Or Amos, I think is how you would actually pronounce it. Excuse me. In a made-up language that he has called Glossian. And this language, Glossian, is nothing more than a set of strung together normal words that, when said in certain combinations, mean something completely different. So if I were to say to you, for instance, banana, stop sign, canoe, mountain, that would mean, like, I don't know, go to the store and get me some ice cream or something. All right? And so, you know, you've got this string of words has absolutely nothing to do with the meaning. The problem is, throughout the entire book, you've got these really weird strung together words that have no meaning to us as the reader, and they're having entire conversations in this thing with absolutely no translation whatsoever. I mean, none. And so you might get through four or five sentences where they're talking in this bizarre, put-together language, and then the story picks up and continues. And you have no idea what the hell they were talking about. No clue. No clue. Nothing. And it just, it makes no sense. At least when Abnett wrote the Malice Darkblade series, at least he included in the back of the book a dictionary so you could look up some of the odd words that Malice Darkblade and the Drow used in the book. There is nothing in this book that even remotely begins to decrypt this bizarre Glossian language. It's just thrown in here for no reason whatsoever. The idea is that I would assume it's some sort of code that the enemy can't decipher, but the reader is not the enemy. You know, you've got to give the reader something that they can go on other than, well, I guess the actions that they're taking now must have been what they were discussing in the previous paragraph, even though the previous paragraph made no sense according to the English language, all right? It's an extraneous bit of writing that doesn't need to be in the book, all right? It's useless. Lastly, and I know I've kind of gone off on the book. There are some good parts. The prologue was awesome. The storyline, meh. The characters, good guys were awesome. The bad guys, except for Gorgon Locke, who you do get a little bit of description and motivation for. Pretty much throwaway characters. But the last thing I want to talk about is the blatant, I mean, blatant Star Wars ripoffs. I mean, it is just pathetic. All right. We've already talked about the bad guy being very Darth Maul-like in his appearance and styling in the book. All right. He appears at the beginning, just like in the previews for The Phantom Menace. And then he doesn't do anything for a really, really long time. And then he shows up at the end, and he's in the movie, or in this case, the book, for like 2 minutes. And then he's gone. Aside from that, there's an Inquisitor in this book who is one of Eisenhorn's longtime friends. And his name is Inquisitor Endor. Now, call me crazy, but could we possibly have come up with a slightly different name than the moon that the Ewoks lived on? I mean, of all of the names that you could have picked, why pick that one? I don't know. It just seems... bad decisions were made. I don't understand why. Let's talk about Gorgon Locke for a second. Gorgon Locke is essentially a pirate. And he's a bad guy. But he's a pirate who is motivated by money and by power. Now, do we know anyone from the Star Wars series who, at least at first, was motivated by money and power? Oh, golly. Oh, it's so hard to think of a character. Oh, I don't know. If I could just think of a solo person, I don't know. It's just, I'm telling you guys, it's really bizarre. These strange pullouts from the Star Wars universe that have been thrown in here, and then the most blatantly pathetic one in the entire book. Eisenhorn is fighting somebody, I don't remember who it was, but he draws his power sword. And there is a description in the book that I was rolling on the floor laughing. It says something along the lines of, and you have to remember this is in first person perspective, it says something like, my power sword is not like one of those archaic types that most people carry. My power sword is really just a handle that when I push the power sword button, a beam of light comes out of it. And I'm like, dude, you have got to be kidding me. This is beyond stupid at this point. I mean, I thought I was just kind of making stuff up in my head when I was comparing Gorgon Locke to Han Solo. And when I was thinking, maybe Inquisitor Endor, maybe we could just call that a massive coincidence. But when Eisenhorn himself has a lightsaber, and we're just calling it a power sword, I mean, we've gone way, way too far into the realm of plagiarism at this point. This is just... And I mean, I don't mind the idea of somebody having a lightsaber, but call it that, okay? Don't pretend like nobody knows what it is that you're talking about. Don't pretend like you just made it up and nobody had ever heard of it before, okay? Have him draw the thing and say, you know what? I got a freaking lightsaber, dude. Back up, alright? Not my power sword is not one of those archaic types with a blade. Mine is special. It has a beam of light that comes out of it. Oh, gag me. It's just, oh, so bad. Anyway, lengthy review, that's okay. I hope you guys have stuck through it. Overall impression of the book, to be perfectly honest with you, it wasn't horrible, but it wasn't great either. To be honest, what you end up with at the end is a slightly below average sci-fi adventure. You know, it could have taken place, to be honest with you, anywhere. Didn't have to even be set in the Warhammer universe, which is fine with me. I actually enjoy the fact that most of the Warhammer 40K and the Warhammer books, aside from the mention of a few things, like in this one, the Emperor's Children is mentioned, and then you have some fluff about the Chaos and the Emperor and the Inquisitors and things like that, but you could really drop it into any setting and just call it a standard sci-fi novel. I like the fact that they don't rub the this is 40K or this is Warhammer stuff in your face. I enjoy that. But the way it was pulled off here, like I said, you just end up with a slightly below average generic sci-fi adventure. Overall score for the Book of Xenos, I'd say 4.5, 5, maybe 5.5 out of 10. Probably closer on the order to between 4.5 and 5. Just a, it's a mediocre book. I wouldn't necessarily recommend it unless you're planning on reading all three of them, which, hey, I've gotten through the first one and I didn't feel like any of the main characters needed to die. So as long as I don't get that feeling when I read a book, I'll usually progress to the next ones. So we'll see how the next ones turn out, but this one just, it left a lot to be desired, to be honest with you, and hopefully it was just a setup for the next two, but really, if you're buying these as a standalone book, which you would have done when they first came out, gosh, I feel pity for the people that had to buy this, because I, to be honest with you, think they wasted their money. Definitely would not have been worth the probably $6.99 that they would have charged, so, you know, take it or leave it, that's my perspective on the thing. If it sounds like something you want to pick up and take a look at, feel free to do it. Like I said, I at the very least, I'd open the thing and read the prologue, because the prologue's awesome, you know? But the rest of the book, really, it just kind of fizzles. So, anyway, that's it for today, guys. I hope that you've enjoyed this book review. Look for many more coming up. Hopefully they won't all be this long. Maybe next time I won't actually take notes when I do the book, and that way I won't remember everything that I didn't like and that I did like. But anyway, I do appreciate you watching. I know it's been a long video. So thank you very much. God bless you all. Have a wonderful rest of the day, and I will see you all in the next video. Be sure to check out our website, www.agpminis.com, where you'll find all of our latest DVD releases, be able to watch all of our free content before we post it here on YouTube, as well as view exclusive content not available anywhere else.